Thank you. Hello, everyone. My name is Valeska Ting. I'm working on developing new composite materials to address challenges in sustainable energies. So to give you a bit of context, the root of the energy challenge is based in our continued global reliance on fossil fuel resources. So we know that fossil fuels are finite in nature. So in the face of increased global populations and increased demand for energy, we're putting more and more pressure on our finite resources, and future resources will become more difficult and more expensive to extract. In addition to this, using fossil fuels results in emissions which contribute to climate change and diminished air quality. And on a social level, because fossil fuel resources are unequally distributed throughout the globe, this contributes to tensions between different nations, and it has impacts on things like energy security and our resilience in terms of changing energy supply. So you can see why we would want to move away from fossil fuel resources to something more renewable. And I think, like you, I believe you saw Dimitra's talk about infrastructure, about smart cities, about the technology and the incredible developments that are being brought into the world at the moment. It's amazing to me that we're powering all of this by things that we dig out of the ground and burn. So there's an imperative to move away from things like this to more renewable resources, and the potential for solar power and wind power is enormous. For example, the incident solar radiation that we get on Earth every day is enough to be able to satisfy our global energy needs many times over. So there's huge potential, and the question is, why aren't we making more use of these sorts of resources? Why are we finding it hard to meet our legislated targets and our commitments to meeting renewable energy generation? The answer to this is because renewable sources like solar and wind are inherently intermittent. So you can't rely on the sun shining or the wind to blow. And the problem is, if you don't have a good way of being able to store the renewably generated electricity at a grid level, and we don't, then this means that you might only be able to turn your lights on when the sun's shining, which is less than useful. To address this, we look to ways of being able to store energy, and hydrogen has been proposed as an enabling technology. So for example, you can take the electricity that's generated on your sunny day or your windy day. You can take that electricity and pass it through water and split the water into its constituent hydrogen and oxygen and collect the hydrogen for later use, where you can use it in things like fuel cell vehicles or even directly combust it. So these are examples of the hydrogen buses and taxis that are in London at the moment. And so if you're thinking about hydrogen as a way of being able to store renewably generated energy, there are many advantages. For example, hydrogen, as I mentioned, can be generated from water, which means that it's abundant and everyone will have access to a source of hydrogen. In addition, it is the most chemically dense, in terms of energy, it's the most chemically dense fuel that we have access to. It has 3 times the gravimetric energy content compared to gasoline. But when you use it in a fuel cell vehicle or in combustion, the only byproduct is regeneration of water. So if you've ever driven behind one of these hydrogen fuel cell buses in London, you might see a trickle of liquid coming out the tailpipe, and that's water. So hydrogen is a non-polluting, potentially renewable, low-carbon alternative to gasoline. But the problem here is, if you look at the tops of these hydrogen buses, I love this picture because you can see the white hydrogen tanks on the tops of the buses. So the problem with converting electricity into something physical that you can put into a tank and store is that if you're looking at hydrogen is a gas, which means it takes up a lot of space. So to be able to carry around enough hydrogen to power your cars, your buses, your trucks, you need to carry it around at very high pressures. So the industry standard at the moment is 350 times atmospheric pressure or 700 times atmospheric pressure. And you can understand that there are safety concerns with carrying around high pressure, potentially flammable gases like this. So what we need to develop is a safer, high density way of being able to store hydrogen. So this is what we're doing here at Bristol. So there are particular materials like these metal organic frameworks, activated carbons, porous polymers that have these microscopic pores. Now these pores are so small that they're invisible to the eye, but what they do is these pores or voids in your structure are perfect for sequestering gases. Nature abhors a vacuum, so when you expose these materials to gases, they spontaneously suck in and store the gases inside the pores at a very high density, which is why these materials are sometimes termed molecular sponges, because they can suck in gases in a similar way to water get sucked into a sponge. Now, these materials are perfect because they enable us to take a large volume of hydrogen gas and store it in a small quantity of solid material, which makes it easier to carry around and access. So what we're doing here in Bristol is by changing the conditions under which you manufacture these materials, you can control the sizes and the shapes of the pores or voids in your material. So we change the manufacturing conditions, we characterize the structures of these materials, and we test them so that we can get a correlation between the structure and the capacity of these materials to develop design rules so that we can develop better, higher capacity hydrogen storage materials. And what we've managed to do, we're optimizing the structure for hydrogen density, and in our best materials, we've discovered that you can densify the hydrogen to 1,000 times what you can in just the bulk gas. And so we're achieving densities that are similar to solid hydrogen, which doesn't naturally occur on Earth. Apparently, sometimes it occurs in the middle of gas giants like Jupiter. So we're achieving densities that you would not otherwise be able to achieve by virtue of these nanoporous materials. So what we need from you is we're doing some incredible research here in Bristol. So we're managing to develop these new materials and to understand what sort of structures we need to achieve these densities. But in order to get this sort of technology adopted, we need people to be receptive to the new technologies. It's very easy to stay wedded to what you know, but if we're going to advance and be able to move towards sustainable energy sources, we need people to become engaged and we need people to be excited about moving on to a new technology. And that's the only way that we'll be able to ensure that we can leave a legacy of sustainable energy for future generations. Thank you.